sitting quietly comes from repentance, mood of repentance, which means that we acknowledge we have a severe continuity problem, and that's the only problem we have. From there, we realize we need to evaporate this continuity problem. Continuity problem is not gotten rid of through force. It's through patience, and it evaporates. The very nature of the problem is a terrible fear of continuity, of too rapid of a shift. So, slow, bit by bit, evaporation. So we're sitting quietly, we're just allowing it to evaporate, the continuity fear. And we're committed to non-action. We're not going to translate anything into action. And this frees our mind up to look deeper, way beneath the surface, where the actual answers to the continuity issue of how to evaporate it are found. They're not found superficially at all. The continuity fear keeps us at superficiality. That's what it does. So when you finally say, hey, I'm tired of superficiality, I want depth, you have to acknowledge, hey, I've got a severe continuity fear, and the effort to go to greater depths of clarity is going to be, I have to manage that. It's something that has to be managed. Because when you start doing that, you're going to see, oh my gosh, I never saw that before. That's incredible. Wow. I'm not as stuck as I thought I was. Wow. Continuity fears less. Wow. And then you wonder, like, well, how am I going to translate that into action? And so you have to sit quietly and don't translate into action. Let it evaporate. Let the continuity fear evaporate. So, sitting quietly is all of this, mood of repentance, humble realization. I have a very severe problem, the continuity problem, extreme fear of a radical break in continuity. So we have to go gently evaporate this fear. We must not translate anything that arises into any action. Otherwise, we're going to be overwhelmed by thinking of how do I implement this new insight into action in the world. We're not going to implement it into action. I'm not going to translate anything into action. So whatever arises, or we're committed to not translating that into any action. So sitting like this then is how we evaporate the continuity fear. How we manage our success is a positive situation. We're not just trying to blank our minds out, trying to attain some still state, we're just realizing we have a severe continuity fear. This is what it takes to evaporate it. We have to manage our success. This is how to manage success. The better we're able to manage our success, the more success we have in being able to recognize deeper and deeper and deeper. You'll be astonished. The deeper you get into the ocean, the depths of your being, depths of your construct here, the more incredible, astonishing the recognitions are. You realize you don't need this realm at all. This realm is like spirit trying to commit silicide. Destruction through silliness. Self-destruct through silliness. The whole world is superficial. Form is superficial. Appearance is superficial. Appearance is entirely superficial. But that can be dropped when we no longer see any plot to form at all. No plot, no storyline. It is just simply appearance. For no reason at all. It's just a play of light. So there are so many really heavy recognitions that people are not getting to. I was scanning YouTube and a lot of spiritual videos. It is completely obvious. People are not getting to it. To get to the real meat, the real essence of the situation, one has to have discipline and be able to manage the path. Manage the success. Manage the success. Success zone. Because the insights are stunning. I had a situation this morning that was the most stunning of all. So I've just been today just managing that. You see, it was so astonishing. So astonishing, so fantastically wonderful. Stupendously wonderful. It was all I could do to keep from sobbing. I was inside sobbing. It was just an incredibly wonderful situation occurred. And so having to manage that today. Now, previously I could not have managed that successfully. I didn't tell anybody. Didn't go into any details, not even here to go into details about it. That's part of the management. Sharing a little bit, the gist of it, just sort of giving you, a heads up. Incredible, astonishing event took place this morning. If I tried to explain it, nobody would believe it. Really, almost nobody. There are some extraordinary ones out there. But even so, sometimes it's better. It's part of managing the success. That's the most important aspect of it all. It's not been easy today to keep my mind in the present. And to keep the fears from coming up, and obviously it was just tremendously unexpected, surprising, and consequential beyond my comprehension. Really, I don't know what's going to happen next. Really, right at this point. So I have to try not to think about the future. Don't flee the future back into the past. Don't get off on some side trip. This is called managing the path. So the best way is to sit quietly like this. I'm sitting at the computer. I'm saying, what do? Everything's superficial. Everything I could think of is superficial. Wow. So I listen to some music. Totally superficial. Do this, do that. No, there's nothing. The more you can just sit quietly like this without trying to do anything, the better it is. Way easier to manage, and from that standpoint then your progress will, you will somehow have the confidence to do something you haven't done before, which is what happened, for me. In my mind, I must have felt I had the capacity to handle the consequences. It's an extremely consequential step I took this morning, extremely. Unfathomably consequential. But I had the capacity through all this discipline to just manage the success and stay present in the moment. Just to go about the day as normal and don't translate anything into action. Don't anticipate. Don't imagine. Just don't let your mind do it. Watch your mind very carefully. So this type of discipline is for sure going to build your confidence up. And that means you are going to make more and more consequential recognitions and shifts, clarifications and insights that you realize, wow, this is leading to something stupendous. Tell I'm nervous, I'm dissociating a little bit because there's songs that are playing in my mind over and over and over. I can't stop them. That means nervous dissociation, trying to just get my attention onto something that's just repetitive like that. So obviously when you take super consequential actions, our decisions or shifts, you're going to pay a price of the jitters. And you have to minimize minimize the trouble. You're going to have trouble for sure. Continuity fear is just, you know, raging. Golf is actually, I find, a spiritual discipline. It can be. You just have to remain very calm, minimize your misses, don't react to any situation. Yeah, you know you're going to get in trouble. You just have to stay even keeled. Don't look ahead, don't look back, stay in the moment. There's lots of time in between shots where you're not doing anything. Just stay calm, stay quiet. You hit your ball out of bounds. Don't start screaming at yourself, telling you how lousy you are, how terrible, what a stupid decision, on and on. You just say, okay. Need to do better on this one. Let's figure out, you know, how to do better here. Let's refocus. It's more like you survived the round. You survived it. You made it through. So anytime you there's a consequential recognition, and you say, "Wow, that's just a life changer. That is just never going to be the same." Actually, after seeing that, you just try to survive the turbulence and have to become very much a survivor. So the depths have to be plumbed, for sure. And the seeming imbalance that seems to occur as the psyche is just a bit turned upside down. You just continue to not react, just stay calm, do not translate anything to action. Do not try to focus on any storyline. Do not try to complete any storyline. Do not try to follow along any sort of storyline at all. Keep in mind, When you see everything as just a play of light, with absolutely reality doesn't need anything to happen, doesn't need any storyline. There is no mental imbalance, so to speak. There is no imbalance because there's no balance at all. To lose your balance, you have to have what's called balance. But in seeing the vision of oneness, there's no balance at all. There's nothing that needs to be balanced. There's nothing to fall. There's no fall anywhere. No one can fall anywhere. Nothing can fall anywhere. Someone sitting on the ground saying, lying on the ground. I'm afraid of falling. I'm afraid of falling. I'm afraid I'm going to fall. What do you mean? You're lying on the ground. Where can you fall to? In the vision of oneness, all is free of time. Now, Jesus tells us it's perfectly all right to honor time and not let go of it right away and do it bit by bit by bit. He totally understands. He says, because time is our grandest illusion. It's the one we cherish and try to cherish and value the most, time. It's also the one that causes us the most trouble, of course. But he said, you're absolutely free to let it go at any moment. Every single moment you can let it go, you're totally free. He's pragmatic. He says, I understand. You know, you probably won't. You may not. You may not. Because you're honoring time. Vision of oneness, there's no time. It's the vision of timelessness. And you see everything as it actually is. Meaning completely free, completely inclusive, completely perfect, with no trouble at all, actually. But time gives the illusion of all these troubles that we think we have, but nobody has any troubles. In reality, because everyone's completely free to choose whatever they want to every moment, so how can we say we have a trouble if there's anything that if we want to experience something different, we're free to do so. So how can we say we're frightened or we have trouble? That means somehow that we feel we're not free. So any talk about timelessness like this really puts a burn on you, and the continuity problem is when the burn comes, it means it's evaporating. The continuity fear is evaporating. You can feel it's just like, wow. It's either that or you argue about it in your mind. So you must avoid arguing about it in your mind to feel it sit into you, seep into your the depths of your being, and just like, and that's when this sort of discomfort and burns and begins, just like, oh, wow. But you know it's doing a world of good for you, a world of good when you allow these really super teachings to listen to them and just accept them. This is true. And don't hold it in your thoughts. Do not hold it in your thoughts at all. Then that's when you start to feel it, the impact of it. And don't raise it back into your thoughts. Just experience the burn without raising it in your thoughts. That's an attempt to disassociate. Thoughts are really disassociation. Thinking is dissociation. But it's very clever because we say, no, I'm thinking about this. How can I be dissociated? I'm thinking about it. That is dissociation. That's continuity fear. So whatever you hear from expression, sharing of teaching, just accept it and don't act on it. Don't translate it into any action, and don't think about it, or don't move it into a level of thinking or thoughts. And then you will feel that it is hitting you hard in as far as and the temptation is to start thinking about it. Which is to dissociate, become very superficial. Because see, it's spirit, what's reacting well? Spirit is emerging. It's like it's spirit's like in the deep bottom of the ocean, so to speak, because we've tried to dissociate it so much. It's rising up, spirit rising. So we're not going to think about it. We're not going to do anything, react to it. We're not going to do anything, act it out in physically anyway. We're not going to take any action. We're not going to translate into any action at all or any thinking at all. And so spirit is we've kind of like the water is less dense, and so it's rising. The less dense it rises more and more. And we feel it. It feels rising, so to speak. It's getting closer. And that's the burn. You know, the burn is like, wow. And it starts to break the surface. And you just say, I'm not going to translate that into any action or thought. So it breaks the surface. And you see the shiningness of spirit. And the fresh. The clean, the purity, the freshness, the shiningness of reality of spirit, and you don't translate that into thoughts or thinking, or reactions or actions. Don't translate it. Do not translate it. Just remain calm and still, and do not translate it. Do not disassociate. Do not translate. It's like a sweat lodge ordeal, kind of. That's the right idea as far as, you just sit, don't move. You get, if you move, start moving, it burns you worse, right? Or it's like an ordeal. Don't try to make it into something. Don't try to manufacture any feeling or any result. Don't manufacture anything. Just stay present with the burn, with the wow. Manage the wow. And you want to get up and run away. Say, okay, that's enough. I think I finished. No, don't do that either. That's why in the sweat lodge, they close the door. You can't get out. That's it. Once you decide to tackle an ordeal, you go all in. Go all in. Then says, okay, I'm going to embrace the challenge and I'm going to succeed at it. I will succeed. No possibility of failure. Keep your mind off of time. Keep your mind off of time. Don't think about time. And after a little while, you realize, hey, it's less. I liken it to eating hot peppers. You think, wow, I'll never get through this ordeal. This is like, wow. And you just stay with it, stick with it, determined not to fail. And then a little while later, you say, hey, it's not so bad now. Still feel the burn, but it's not so bad. Is the good way to do it is to feel like your life depends upon it, depends upon a success. Your life depends upon it. Your mental stability depends upon it. It does, because, you know, this may seem like we're forcing the issue here, where we intentionally stress our mental stability, overall stability, by looking deeper than, you know, where we're usually balanced, and realizing that. There isn't any balance. We don't need any balance there. We don't need to be balanced there. And then that feels temporarily like an imbalance. But really is there's no balance. There's nothing to fall from, so to speak. There's no falling. It's perpetually realizing more and more we can't fall. We cannot fall. We cannot lose our balance. There is no balance to lose. So what we call our mental construct is a balance. But we gradually realize that we don't need a mental construct. We do not need a mental construct, a personality, an I. We do not need it. But progressively, we realize this. We feel temporarily like, whoa. You know, like, wow. And if we try to translate into action, people might think that we're starting to become mentally unstable. Because we're taking all these great actions to try and stabilize. And people say, why are you doing too much? You're over the top. It's like that, so you don't. You have, the path has to be commitment to non-action. Commitment to non-action. So, like your life depends upon it, and it, in a lot of ways, your mental stability, your stability, the stability of perfect non-stability. Realizing there is no such thing as stability. Reality has no need for stability. Reality has no need for any stability. Okay, this is another profound affirmation. Reality has no need for any stability. And that's putting a severe burn right there. Reality has no need for any stability. Now the world is going to become the mind of the world is going to become unstable this autumn. The mental state of the world is going to become unstable. The world is going toward mental instability because it's dwelling on the superficial levels only, where it feels as though there's a tremendous need for stability. But that also, keep in mind, when you feel there's this extraordinarily important need for stability, you are believing there's an extraordinary situation of instability. It's dualistic. And it makes you very insecure and unstable. The belief in tremendous instability does make you unstable. And you become silly, thinking that silliness is stability. And I call it silicide. The world's going to commit silicide this autumn. This was I look at the world, I'm just assessing it, taking the temperature, you know. And if silicide is like 100 degrees, if the temperature right now is 99, and it's still mid, you know, just the middle, it hasn't reached the end of the day where it gets hotter. The 4 o'clock time or something, you know, the autumn time, it hasn't reached it yet. It's going to go into silicide. So we are in this race to realize reality doesn't need any stability. That realization is there. It's unquestionably there. I've seen it. I know it's there. It's a matter of managing the success and the continuity. You see it, and you have to manage the fact that you've seen it. It's such a huge wow. You just realize, oh my gosh, this is it. Yeah, this is it. This is reality. This is it. And so you then need to, that's such an extreme wow. You have to manage that success. And so do not be discouraged if you see something profound. You may even see the nature of reality, which I did several days ago, and then it seems to disappear. Now be conscious about all the whole time. Be conscious. Don't disassociate. I'm aware it's right there, hasn't disappeared. I simply have a continuity issue, and I'm managing the success like, wow, how do I translate it into action? Oh, I don't need to. I don't need to. I don't need to. Gradually you calm down. You realize I don't need to translate that into any action. Otherwise, you'd be completely freaked out if you didn't do that. There's nothing to translate into any action. The reality is not translatable. So, seeing that, you have to readjust your overall expectations to, I don't need to translate into any actions. There's no need. There is no instability. There is no need. That's even important. There is no need. Talk about reality in terms of need, okay? Always talk about in terms of need, and always say there is no need. This is just the ultimate effective root of affirmations. There is no need. Reality doesn't have any needs. And then you can itemize them all. Yeah, reality doesn't have any need for stability. Reality has no need for stability because there is no issue of instability. So there is no stability, instability. It has no need for concepts. Reality has no need for dualistic concepts at all. Reality simply is. It is what is. And there's nothing that needs to get that. There's nothing that needs to get that. Reality doesn't need anything to get that. Reality doesn't need anything to get reality. Reality doesn't need to be gotten at all. So speak at the level of needs, of need. This is super potent. But manage your success. Don't just try and be a superhero and say, you have to manage your success. You realize this reaction, wow, which is basically, it's a paradox. You seem temporarily like vulnerable because really you're realizing you're not vulnerable and you're not used to it. It's a continuity fear. So you're in a state of continuity fear. And this is all important so you don't misconstrue the whole situation you're in. You're conscious of it, saying this is not, I'm not playing mind games. It's not a paradox. I'm not really, this is simply my continuity fear. It wasn't dreaming, you know, I actually saw this. It didn't flee away from me. I didn't do anything wrong. All of that is easily managed when you recognize it is simply a continuity fear that you're dealing with right now. Nothing else. And then you just say, okay, just stay calm, be patient, and let's evaporate this. And everything will be fine. Everything will be, fine, no problem. That's it. This is how to have success on the path. The kind of success that we deserve. We absolutely deserve success on the path. Absolutely deserve it. Absolutely have to get it, actually. We need to realize there are no needs. Right? We need to realize there are no needs. That's the only need there is to drop the continuity fear so we can accept that there are no needs. Reality doesn't have any needs. How could it be needy? How could reality be needy? There's nothing missing. There's never anything missing. And you can work with the need and on affirmations. I don't need in any way. You can use it in any way possible, right? Even in the double contradictory way, it's fine. That all has an impact. I don't need no needs. As I say, reality doesn't need reality. That's right. Reality doesn't need reality. That's absolutely true. That's a super strong one. Reality doesn't need reality. And again, you just accept it. It's like breathing in air. You just accept, you breathe it in. Breathe in the affirmation. Not literally the air, but breathe it in spiritually. Into the depths of your being. And bypass all your thinking and thoughts, all the filters that say what you can think, what can you allow in to your attention. Where can your attention be? Is really all your filters are attention filters. And so just allow this into the depths, your attention to go into the depths. That reality doesn't need reality. That's a incredible potency, incredibly potent. Now, are these affirmations dangerous? No. Let your attention focus on it when to the extent that your continuity fear allows it. So your continuity fear will automatically block however much you're frightened of, it will block that. So it will remain superficial, which is okay. So doing these superficially is okay because gradually it will deepen. And by practicing it, you gradually can get deeper and deeper. Then you can be like, wow, And then you manage, you have to learn to manage your success more and more and more. You don't have to say some affirmation 1,000 times. It has nothing to do with how many times you say it. You can say it just a few times until you allow it in. You allow your attention to the depths that it points to. Reality doesn't need reality. It's pointing to the absolute truth. You allow your attention there. That's it. The wow is right there. The bird is there. It's just a wow. I see it. That's all. That's all you need. You just need to see it. Once you see it, that's when you had, then you have to manage the seeing of it. Reality doesn't need reality. All doesn't need the all, right? All doesn't need the all. Oneness doesn't need oneness. Oneness doesn't need oneness. Oneness is oneness. It doesn't need oneness. See, we keep thinking that oneness, we're trying to find the oneness because oneness needs oneness, and we're trying to find it. No, oneness doesn't need oneness. Life doesn't need life. Every awareness doesn't need every awareness. Eternity doesn't need eternity. Eternal life doesn't need eternal life. You see, it's the belief that reality needs reality that puts us in this fragmented, terrible, fragmented mindset here, thinking that, well, there's something that it needs. Reality needs something. And so it automatically causes all these fragments and thoughts and terrible troubles that we're in. So if we dissolve all that, reality does not need reality. Reality does not need reality. Reality does not need reality. It's kind of like we have this little shack house and the wind is blowing. These affirmations are like wind and blowing away pieces of the house bit by bit by bit. And we're in the house and, oh boy, here comes the wind again. But we find when the house is gone, everything's perfect, everything's great. Oh wow, this was hiding. You know, I was hiding in the house. Don't need to hide anymore. Reality doesn't need any hiding. Reality doesn't need to hide. Reality doesn't need to hide. Reality doesn't need to hide. All of this here we're seeing is an expression of need. This is an expression of the belief in need. Reality doesn't need anything. Reality doesn't need anything to happen. Reality doesn't need any action. Reality doesn't need any needs. Reality doesn't even need reality. So we no longer need to see all of this as an expression of need, which is actually time. The illusion of time is the delusion of need. Because in isness, we would see isness doesn't need isness. Isness is. So if we don't see that, we're believing in time. Which is belief in need. Something is needed. Something additional to isness is needed. So where could that be? It has to be in some process. Where's the next moment is linked. So where, what is that? Time, belief in time. The belief in the lack of freedom. We need, is that freedom? I need, is that freedom? Is that perfect freedom to say, I need? How can there be say, I need and also have perfect freedom? It's not possible, is it? I know I need. Oh, I'm free, but I need to do this. This is needed. The only need we have is to evaporate the continuity fear of time, belief in time and needs. That's a pragmatic need, not an absolute need. It's a pragmatic need, which God recognizes. Reality says, "Yeah, that's a pragmatic need. No problem." Obviously, if we believe in needs and cannot let go of that out of terrible fear of continuity fear, then we need to be able to find the way to let go of it, for sure. But that doesn't change the isness at all. It doesn't change the isness at all. I can say I have a need to. It's tricky. You say I have a need to realize I don't have a need, and that can kind of get in the way. If you push too hard and try too hard, then it starts being counterproductive. Actually, it's very tricky. Just sort of stay with it. Stay with what's going on, the evaporation of it. But don't turn it into some overwhelming need that I need to get to this, I've got to get to it now, I need that. Then you start losing it, you start backing away, imposing a need. The whole idea is we're seeing that there is no need. Nothing needs to awaken. Like I said, I really got to awaken, I really need to awaken. Be careful. Say nothing needs to awaken. Nothing needs to awaken. Now, by doing that, you are awakening faster. Don't say, I need to awaken. Say, no, nothing needs to awaken. So you're recognizing, yes, we do need to awaken. Pragmatically, we need to actually realize that nothing needs to awaken. And we need to realize that nothing needs to awaken as soon as possible, actually. Because of the instability of the world. Mental instability in this world is extreme. All of this effort to bring about mental instability has had its effects. All of the media, the television, newspapers, magazines, internet, movies, music, laws, activism, everything to bring about instability has certainly had a dramatic effect. Super, 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 super effect, of course. That's like saying if there's torrential downpour and it never lets up, you're going to see flooding. Of course. The world has been this torrential downpour of trying to destabilize. And of course, that is going to have its destabilizing effects. As they say in the old archaic farming analogies, you reap what you sow. And for those who don't know, I always struggle with some of those farming analogies, but you harvest what you plant. is a same way of saying it. You harvest, you're going to harvest what you plant. You plant wheat, you're going to harvest wheat. You plant weeds, you're going to harvest weeds. So, if you plant instability, which is what's been done in the world, massive instability, then you're going to harvest massive instability. And harvest time is what? Autumn. Autumn is the harvest time. So, come this autumn. I mean, come harvest time, whatever that may be, but it's coming. I would say this autumn is a good way to look at it. The harvest coming in is the harvest of instability, which of course everybody thinks is protection from no stability, no need for any stability from reality, because they look at it in a dualistic way and they say, my God, there's no stability there. Oh my gosh, I gotta flee this place, it's horrible. No, there's neither stability nor instability. There's no such situation. Isness does not have any such situation like that. There's no need for stability, because there isn't any possibility of instability. So when you look at it that way, you say, hey, that sounds like a pretty good situation. I don't need to flee from that. Let me plant wheat so I can harvest wheat. Again, be careful not to go off on your thoughts. Speaking, doing this is tricky. You know, it's not easy. But it forces one to stay focused. You start going off on your thoughts, you cannot deliver a cohesive sharing here. Which is why I say use your dumb phones, turn them into smartphones, record yourself, or at least have a monitor there. And so you practice like, hey, I've got to really stay in the present here. And deliver something relevant, share something highly relevant. So, mental instability. Coming to the world, we need to be what? Beyond dualism. Completely solid block of oneness. Doesn't need any, there's no issue of stability, is there? So we need to get there, and we are, for sure. So continue this patience, recognize the continuity fear, which speeds things up greatly, speeds things up greatly. And say, instead of saying, I need to succeed, say, reality doesn't need any success. Reality doesn't need any success. Reality doesn't need to find anything. Doesn't need any finding. Doesn't need any attainment. Reality doesn't need any attainment. No one needs to attain anything. No one needs to succeed at all. No one needs to attain anything. No one needs to realize anything. There is no need for realization. So it's really about just letting go of our needs, letting go of this belief in needs. And then that's really letting go of time, right? Seeing through letting go of time. Okay. So, tomorrow. Tomorrow's another day, and just stay focused on right now, so that tomorrow will be another chapter in the non-chapter, the non-book of reality. Another absence of a chapter from the non-book of reality. Reality doesn't need any book. Reality doesn't need the book reality. Alright, so reality does not need reality. Reality does not need reality. In any form whatsoever, reality does not need reality. In any form whatsoever, in any appearance whatsoever, does not need, reality does not need any appearance of reality. Reality does not need any appearance of reality. In whatever form whatsoever, whether subtle, gross, doesn't matter. Reality doesn't need any appearance of reality. So if you get to some additional depth like this, don't run away from it. I was ready to finish, and I said, well, wait a minute. Try a little bit more. So, okay, wow. Reality doesn't need any appearance of reality. That's even more profound. You see, that's getting into the nitty-gritty even more. So what I find is you get to, you're almost ready to finish, and then if you just push a little more, you get, wow, you may have a big breakthrough. So don't be in too much of a hurry to finish. Do not be in too much of a hurry to finish. Usually, take a little extra, try a little extra. That's what I found. I always went the extra mile. Late at night, you know, it's 1 a.m, and say, wow, I just gotta stop. I say, well, let me just go one, you know, half an hour more or whatever. Go the extra mile. That's another secret. Go the extra mile. So, I have had this astonishing experience this morning, which portends to be incredibly consequential. So, all I gotta do is get to the next day. It's another great success. And of course, reality doesn't need any success, absolutely. Does not need reality, so to speak, right? Okay. Just manage your success. Manage your success as best you can. All right. Very great. That's it.